Patients who have twin-twin transfusion syndrome, especially if they have polyhydramnios in the one twin, can become very uncomfortable physically with this pregnancy because the uterus gets stretched beyond what is normal for that gestational age.
For our moms that are carrying twins affected with twin-twin transfusion syndrome that have been classified as stage one, and are demonstrating signs or symptoms of maternal discomfort or are having irregular uterine contractions or are demonstrating shortening of the cervix, then amnioreduction is a therapy that can be offered. The idea behind amnioreduction is primarily as a temporizing measure where we can actually draw off the excessive amount of amniotic fluid that's in the recipient fetus's sac in order to provide not only maternal comfort but also to avoid preterm contractions which can lead to preterm delivery.
A needle is passed into the amniotic sac under ultrasound guidance just like an amniocentesis would be. Amniotic fluid is then able to be removed so that this excessive fluid is drawn down into a more normal range.
Nowadays, amnioreduction has a very limited place in the management of twin-twin transfusion syndrome. For our moms who are excluded as operative candidates either because they are stage one or for other maternal indications, amnioreduction can be utilized, and when applied to these particular pregnancies can actually demonstrate a halting of the progression of twin-twin transfusion syndrome.
But sometimes you see progression. You'll see that the heart of the recipient baby is becoming more affected, that the ability to pump blood is worse, that the leaking of the valves is getting worse.
If a pregnancy progresses in terms of upstaging, even after amnioreduction, continued ultrasound surveillance is warranted. And at that point, a discussion is held with families regarding the next option or next management strategy that can be employed. If gestational age allows for it, then a selective laser can be performed even after an amnioreduction has been utilized.
That's a procedure that's much more invasive to the patient. It requires that the patient go to the operating room.
What happens with our moms is that they are admitted to the hospital early in the morning. They're taken to the operating room, and under conscious sedation as well as local anesthetic that's applied to the abdomen, we can introduce a fetoscope, which then allows direct visualization of these communications so that we can perform a targeted and focused ablation.
There are blood vessel communications or vascular communications that occur along the surface of the placenta, and the challenge is to be able to recognize where those communications are. And so now, using sophisticated endoscopic approaches, we're able to go into the sac of the recipient baby, identify where the umbilical cord inserts into the placenta, and then we literally map every single blood vessel arising from that point out, either a artery from one baby connecting straight into the arterial system of the other baby. It can be veins connected to veins directly, or the most common is when a vessel from one baby enters into the placenta and then comes out of the placenta and goes to the opposite baby. And then using a laser fiber, we're actually able to coagulate or kind of spot weld those communications shut.
Laser on.
Effectively separating the single placenta into two separate components, one for each fetus.
Then each twin has its own placental mass. There's no longer this communication, and hopefully that will interrupt the twin-twin transfusion process and stabilize the situation until you can get out to a gestational age, deliver the babies where there's a good chance of survival.
Although fetoscopic laser coagulation is a minimally invasive procedure, it is a surgical procedure, and as such carries with it specific risks. Those risks include preterm contractions that could ultimately lead to preterm labor and delivery. There is also the risk of preterm rupture of membranes. And the third risk is of membrane separation. The sort of cumulative risk for any one of those complications occurring after laser surgery is in the neighborhood of 10 to 15%. Alternatively, the risk of not moving forward with an intervention when formally diagnosed with twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome carries with it a risk of 80 to 85% of loss of the pregnancy.
And so you really have to weigh the risks against the potential benefits.
We are incredibly fortunate to be operating in a center that has allowed for the reception of a tremendous volume of families who are referred to us for twin-twin transfusion syndrome specifically. As a result, we've been able to develop a multidisciplinary program that incorporates all levels of care that are specifically targeted towards the care of families affected by twin-twin transfusion syndrome.